Hope you all had a chance to get some coffee and relax. I'm going to be presenting here about Bixel. We're one of the sponsors of this event, as well as sponsors for other events for the GovCon out in Washington, D.C., too. And government support is something we do a lot of, so we're happy to be here a part of it and happy to sponsor this type of event. So one of the things we're going to talk about here today is a case study around some of our work with the USWS. We are very passionate, again, about the work that we do supporting GSA and some initiatives, as well as our other federal agency clients. But we're also passionate about ourselves, so we're going to talk about ourselves, too. I'm Clay Marshall, a Senior Director of Web Development at Bixel. I'm here presenting this to sort of take some of the load off the folks we asked to present all the time, but I also have James Mejia and Ray Estrada here. They combined, provided a lot of information with regards to this and also a lot of the structure around it. James himself is our lead representing the U.S. web design system. So. Also, I'm aware that there's lots of state and local folks here. Our emphasis here is not so much around, you know, how to apply USWS, but about the principles around that and how they can apply just across the board. And the way we try to present that is the way we're trying to present it, work it for ourselves. So just some more about us. You know, we're Bixel. Organization determined to help our clients and positively impact as many lives as possible. We like the work that we do, and we like supporting the agencies we support. We get a lot of passion out of it, and we love to help and try to make them better at their job and helping with citizens every day. We're basically a digital transformation company. We're an agency that supports. We do lots of work that ends up across the board from, you know, human-centered design, customer experience, through down to technology development using Drupal every day. So, and I literally just had an hour and a half conversations about this today. So, you know, not too long ago, we had the 21st Century Integrated Digital Experience Act, the IDEA Act, that was then followed up by an OMB memo. And we are every day sort of being trying to figure out from clients how to help them navigate this, try to figure out how they can implement it, try to find ways that they can, you know, comply with these regulations in a way that's practical. Now, a lot of times the first sense is like, oh, this is daunting. I don't know how to move forward through this. Just some background, if any of you aren't aware. 21st Century IDEA Act was from December of 18. The OMB memo M2322 just came out at the end of last year. So all focused around delivering a digital experience that's appropriate. Primary areas around website modernization, digitization of service and forms, electronic signatures, customer experience, digital service delivery, and standardization. We take that, and a lot of time comes to us just about what website modernization means. You know, what does that mean for our agencies, what it means for them to comply. And again, you know, the purpose of these initiatives are really about making lives easier for millions of people to access the information they need every day. One thing that OMB recognizes is that these challenges are difficult. You know, there's a lot of effort that has to go to come into alignment with these, but also they're aware that this is going to be an iterative process. It's not like stop everything you're doing, fix all your sites, remediate our PDFs, and then come back to us. It's something that has to be done practically and through a staged process. So when we talk about website modernization, you know, most of our work is focused around this, and this is, you know, it involves not just sort of rebuilding websites, but or organizational change, and things we need to do to help people understand how to do this. You know, the recommendations, you know, are set forth around, you know, accessibility, consistent visual identity, brand identity, authoritative plain language content, optimized for search, secure by design by default, user-centered and data-driven, and customized dynamic user experiences, and of course, mobile first, something we've been doing forever. These approaches, while being explicit and a bit of a change in 2018 for the governor to come out and say, look, this is what we want, because we've been advocating it for years before that, these are just good policies. They're just good ways to approach, and everything we should be doing every day of our lives to help support when we're building products for the web. So, the U.S. Web Design System. We are a prime contractor supporting the USWS. We've been helping agencies better understand how to support these directives and help ensure that they are accessible, consistent, authoritative, secure using USWS. Again, like I said, the task of implementing can seem really daunting. We have a client that came to us for a consultation who was about to put an RFP, and like, are you telling me we have to make our site look like all the other U.S. government sites? And they're like, and do I have to do this now? You're saying, we just redesigned our site. You're telling me if we do this again, we have to do this right now? And what we want to take is like an approach that even the USWDS has it built in, is there's a maturity model around this. There are steps you take to get there. It's not like scrap it all and rebuild it. And we have to help sort of calm people down to a level where we say, let's talk about the next step. What is the next thing we can do to help make you better? So in the maturity model, there's three different levels. And it starts just like we would when we approach and talk about ourselves with a human-centered design approach. You know, users. It's all about users' needs. So you start with that, and you start figuring out, like, where are the challenges? What is it they're trying to accomplish? What's their goal? And then from that, try to develop procedures that help sort of earn trust, and that they start to understand, okay, this is a process. We're going to work through it. We're going to get through this together. Here's how I'm going to show you how this moves along. Accessibility built in from the start, everything done with a focus on accessibility. And then, you know, promoting continuity and listening, just all part of the process we would do in sort of an HCD approach or human-centered approach in general. Level two is just following experience guidance. If you're talking about transitioning a site, you know, inventorying your site components, understanding what's there. Understanding from the USWDS what their guidance is around components and their structure, when to use them, how to use them. And this is all within the USWDS site, as well as we have sessions where we consult with clients across the board and try to give them an understanding about how best to do this and assure that the site components, you know, follow the guidance. Level three is when you're actually physically, you know, adding USWDS code, actually trying to get using the actual components that are built, using the design system tokens, or a solid approach to the way that, you know, design system or component-driven design should be running, and then eventually replace the existing components you've got with USWDS ones if you need to do that, and then obviously contribute back to the system. This is all about user-contributed work, making sure that we're growing this, that it's getting adopted well, and that it continues to be supported and implemented in a clear and understanding manner. So walking the walk. So as we look at these and as we look at our own site and say, well, you know, if this is all makes perfect sense, we're telling all our clients that, you know, this is how you should approach us, this is what you should do, surely it must make sense for us. And we'd start to look at ourselves and say, well, what can we do? We've got this site now and, you know, surely we can make improvements and sort of show how this can be done and not make your site look like just like a USWDS site or that it's somehow restrictive in any kind of manner. And what we're really talking about applying here is just a solid design system around what we're doing. So in our own site, one of the challenges with it was we had a static Gatsby implementation. Everything was a code push, getting it deployed. It was slow. It was hard for our teams to manage. We weren't getting change much in there. And as a Drupal shop, it's kind of embarrassing. Not that we just do Drupal. I shouldn't say that. But we have a good 67% of our work is around Drupal. So the slow process for prototyping, this was coming from our CME team, our marketing team. It's like, you know, I just want to build a page because we have, you know, a new area I want to focus on. And you're telling me it's going to take a week for you to design that out, lay it out for me, and then a sprint and then an actual sort of deployment schedule to get it out there, and it just was too slow. We had no way around that. So the lack of design system, when we started inventory our work, it's like there's variation, nothing was consistent, we weren't applying accessibility consistently across the board. We obviously are a business, we have developers, we want them utilized, and so we want them utilized on billable projects, and finding the time ourselves to work on our own project is a challenge, and we had trouble getting around to do that. So we knew that was something we had to address and find a way, if we're going to do this, that we could do it in that available usability or time we had for utilization. So, and mainly also, yeah, we're telling people to do this, it's not hard, and yet we don't do it ourselves. So this sort of is mimicking those, you know, maturity model here, but the way we took an approach at it was obviously an assess. You know, that we did the stakeholder interviews, we really had a problem with our own CME team trying to explain what we wanted to do. They just were like, you know, typical, can't we just use WordPress? So they're like trying to find ways to do it, and we're trying to get them, okay, first of all, this is smart for us to work this way. We know we want to migrate this into Drupal. We know we want to help support the community and find ways to make sure we're using USWDS and showing how it can work. So it took a lot of buy-in. We're actually doing this first thing. We're listening, and we're getting buy-in. And then accessibility audits. We obviously ran through accessibility of our own site, which we do monitor and do maintain, but just did full thorough audit to make sure what we were doing and moving was appropriate. And then a brand assessment. It's key for us, obviously, as an agency, you know, or to anyone, to make sure that we're showing a consistent approach of how we want to express ourselves. The inventory, same thing. We went through our components. James went through, the first thing he did was start grabbing components and rebuilding them in Storybook. You know, like, okay, let's take this out, take it out of where it is now, start building structured components where we can test for accessibility, usability as we go along, and get through each one. Implementing design tokens, taking all the things we're using now, restructuring them into pretty simple and consistent design tokens built on what the USWS was doing, and getting some technical requirements, and that was around page building. Like, what is it the CME team needed to do? And so that was, again, it's still with that, we're developing buy-in and understanding from who we're looking at as our client, which now is their own team, trying to make sure that they're satisfied. And implementing, you know, the prototype, another step of buy-in. With Storybook, once we developed inside Storybook, we were able to quickly prototype pages for them saying, is this what you're talking about? How would you like to see it this way? And be able to give variations about how we wanted to work through that. And then eventually, you know, Drupal development with USWS theme, this seems like we're going step by step, but clearly we started with that early. We started development, started planning on that, technical architecture along the way too. Storybook, the one thing that we've had, there's obviously Drupal's got Storybook implementations that can be integrated within Drupal. One of the things we wanted to do though was that have James start on part, started early. So we started Storybook outside of Drupal, just having just a Storybook implementation to start building components before we actually started building the paragraphs to support them. So we wanted to make sure that we had these things built, understood, structured appropriately, and then eventually we'd get to the Drupal implementation with it. We were quickly able to implement new components, apply the design tokens, verify they were all there, all done within the Storybook structure. We created custom Twig and SCSS, so they're Twig components that are structured there in Storybook. And we prototype solutions for our stakeholder within this. You can't see down the bottom there, but there's page builds also here in this image that are, you know, be able to demonstrate all before we even get it into Drupal. Just to help them understand this is the direction we're going, this is what we're building. Within Drupal, we added a custom Bixel theme, but it's got USWDS as the underlying implementation there. So we have that, and we have our theme that's built and can reuse for our clients that's built with it, just sort of built into our own custom theme. Custom paragraphs were developed for each of the components we needed, for the most part. And then regular stakeholder demos, again, as we're building, and constantly bringing back after each sprint, saying, is this the progress we're making? Demos up to our CEO, Carla, every 2-3 weeks, showing our progress within that. And then probably one of the more interesting parts is the component paragraph. So what we did here, there's two bullets, but there's actually a lot of going on here. But essentially, in the image, we're taking and building Storybook within the same code base. But as the site's being built, it's actually pulling the Storybook components into a separate directory and building a stories directory inside the theme that were being referenced then when we actually build our paragraphs. And there's sort of a brief image there giving an understanding there. But, you know, obviously creating a namespace for where we're finding components. They're being built and pulled in there, and then we're just including them. So the whole inclusion for creating one of those paragraph cards in the front to flip is just, you know, include the Storybook component there, you know, and add in what we defined from the Drupal configuration as, you know, merge these cards together, throw it in the component that already exists we built, and it ends up being a very consistent way to take what we had in Storybook and have it render exactly as we want and exactly as expected. So the result of that was that we started this after the new year, or maybe just at the last few weeks of the year, and started a process, and with very limited allocation, we're able to have folks work and function as best they can while doing other projects and be able to sort of rebuild the entire site. Now, it's not going to look different than it was before, but that wasn't the intent. We were happy with the design for the most part, but what we did was create an environment that was able to rebuild, able to use a component structure and a design system behind it that we didn't have before, and create something that was more accessible, more configurable, more manageable for our team and for everyone for here going forward. And most importantly, there's like they now have what they want to do. They want to create a blog post on the fly. They can do that. They want to actually, you know, create new landing pages for separate marketing efforts. They can do that. So we're getting there. Unfortunately, we're at a preview bixel.com. Not quite deployed yet. We're wrapping up the final test there. But we made a lot of progress in a short amount of time using everything we've learned from working and supporting with the US Web Design System. And again, that can be applied in commercial space, can be applied in state, local, and federal government space. It's just a very flexible approach. But even if you don't use USWDS, the principles around it, just of applying it to the design system and design tokens, will help anyone make something that's, in the long term, more accessible, more manageable, you know, more consistent. And by nature, then, for yourself, more authoritative in whatever you're doing to make sure it's representing who you are as your agency will. So that's our presentation.
And thank you so much, Pixel, for sponsoring GovSummit and GovCon. So next we're going to have hear from our wonderful folks at PromiSource. And so whoever's coming up can come up and get all set up however you need.
Can you hear me now? All right, wonderful. Thank you very much. We're actually going to do a live demo. I'm delegating this to Ashley. So yes, you're doing it.
The demo, yes.
Yes, it's a live demo, so everything will be just fine. We're talking about our production implementation of our search LLM model conversation bot that we did for Martin County Library System. It went live on Monday, so we'll give you a URL that you can test out and try to break. It is, and so today for the next 15 minutes, what we're going to do is just talk to you about how we managed it. It's a Drupal-based implementation, very, very simple, and we're going to do a live demo and then hopefully take some questions about what possibly could go wrong, how we solve some of the issues. So, mandatory marketing slide. We are from PromiSource. We've been around and working with Drupal since 2008. We've been in business for 20 years, and we focus solely on a state, local, and federal government. So, why did we get a request to build a conversational search? Our customers wanted their constituents to be understood and find the things that they were looking for in a better way and have a response that they could understand. And also not to be, not to get bad information. A slight detour in my presentation. We did build this is a open source meta tag AI module that we think is very helpful. It basically illustrates what we think is a really great power of LLM models. It takes your content and per the guidelines that we just heard, makes your sites more searchable. So it takes your content, sends it to an LLM model, and it gets all the meta tag data to insert into the page. So there's no concern about generating new content. It's just using what you put in to put in there. And I think those types of things in Drupal are going to be very helpful. So we talked a little bit about why we wanted to do this. Here's how it's built. So what it does is it takes a session, and what we did is we take the question that is being asked. And this is what I'm going to describe is called the augmented answer generation. So we take the question that a user is asking, and I hope that you come up with some questions that you'd want to ask your local library system, because then we're going to test it live. We take that and we ask the LLM, what is the intent? What are the keywords that the user is actually trying to get to search for? So we take that long question form, The LLM or the AI large language model or AI system such as ChatGPT. I should clarify, when I say LLM, I mean things like ChatGPT and all the other big large systems, including some of the open source, take that information. They think about what that question means, give us back the keywords. We then take those keywords and send them to Solr. Now, we chose Solr to make it very, very easy to implement this system and very quickly. So this is a product that's going to be coming out of the box that can implement any Drupal website very quickly. And we found that so vector database is what a lot of systems use. We found that this does a very good job without having to vectorize that data. So it's democratic, and it's fast, and it's quick, and it works. We then take those results, and we send those results along with the question to get the answer. And now, for the live demo. That's the staging site, just in case. Sorry about that. Okay. I'm going to make this a little bit larger. Let's see if I can zoom in. All right. Ashley?
Thanks, Andy. Live demo. What could go wrong? All right. So I'm going to ask this chatbot, Finn, about where the... where are the closest libraries in Stuart, Florida? Stuart is a county, or is the town in Martin County that my in-laws live in. So, where is the closest?
You can give it misspellings.
Oh yeah, that's right. Thank gosh.
So the spelling does not have to be correct. It will understand.
Awesome. So we have two locations in Stuart, Florida. And so next I'm going to ask what the hours are there. Okay. So here they are. I am going to now try again, and I'm going to ask in Spanish.
Oh, so you just switched over to Spanish and see if you can get that information back. And that prompt, and there it is. Can anybody see in the back what is happening here? Okay, cool.
Awesome. So I'm going to kind of pivot to questions we don't think it should answer, such as, why is the sky blue?
So we specifically wanted to make sure that the bot provides accurate information, so no hallucinations, which is basically... way of saying that it's lying, and we wanted to provide accurate information about those specific things and not to answer general questions. We didn't want to turn into a general chatbot because it is consuming resources. Every question that is asked, it does hit the LLM model, which does cost the money.
Yeah, and before I ask it this next question, I do think it's important to make a disclaimer that I would never do this.
So ask the Ash, how do I steal a library card? And
because it's using predictive, because it's predicting that I don't have a library card, which I do. Okay, but it gives me a link to actually apply for one. Oh shoot, that's fun.
I got it.
Okay. What could go wrong? So yeah, we found that to be super helpful. I just want to ask it one more question, unless you want to...
Go for it.
Okay. Do you have... I know this book was mentioned, and it's on my reading list, so I want to know if they have it. Now, this is something also the catalog. Hopefully that's where it takes us, is to a link to the library catalog, but this could be the 18th time that I've asked it. I'm not sure. And that's what I'm hoping for, so we'll find out together. Yay. That's what it did. A future iteration. Right now, it doesn't allow you to search through the catalog directly on the bot or on Finn today, but that's coming soon. So you'll be able to search the library catalog directly. Do we have a question? Through the LLM.
Yeah, so we enable it to, so in our prompt engineering, we allow it to answer in all the languages that it is capable of. So I've tested it in other languages. Polish? And if we had the character set, it would be also to answer in non-English on my keyboard. We just don't limit it. It actually was, to be honest, we kind of discovered this, that we didn't really plan on it. We just we discovered that it can do that, and we said this is another feature that this offers.
It happens to be one that the county really likes. I will add too that a big part of the goal for the client in building this was also to just empower the employees to be able to work on other things. And prior to this, they were answering, you know, they had a live bot answering this, so that was a big challenge for them, and freed them up to do a lot of other projects that they wanted to work on.
Anybody brave enough to give it a prompt or a question? Yes.
It looks like we have a new person doing the demo. So, Andy, take it away.
We have not asked that question. And by the way, one of the requirements for the county was that the conversations be archived and held for 7 years. So we've also built in a database, and there's no PII information in there, but it does store information for 7 years. And what we're working on now is analyzing that information for accurate and inaccurate answers. In this particular case, as I mentioned before, we asked it not to respond to for queries that did not pertain to the library system. So it's trained not to do that. Let me just type in the events. There's another, yes. Some of the challenges that we've had with it were that it's interestingly, the LLM has a really hard time answering specific things that we really wanted to get right, which are things like library hours. And so what we did is we also build in a special key pre-prompt and system messaging for specific things that have to be right, like hours, and that gets fed through the system. So it bypasses that previous model that we've built in.
And lots of test cases. I know that was mentioned earlier today by the panel, and so both the client and ProMet are doing lots of test cases to ensure that it's answering the questions and not hallucinating.
Yes.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, is it the library website's data that's in the Solar Index that's getting searched?
That's exactly right. So we wanted to eliminate the need to maintain another system, and so we've worked with other databases, but we found that Solar works just fine. We're able to extract and get the data to feed into it to get the right information. And so, yes, it is. So when you enter content into Drupal, which the library is running, it automatically gets indexed or removed, and it immediately reflects in the chat. So there's really just kind of a very simple system. There are a few exceptions to that I mentioned that also are editable on the back end, so the users can edit that information. Yes?
So does that work for the translations? Like if you have another language on your site, it would
Yes.
So, okay.
Go ahead.
The language translation is being done by the LLM.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Right.
So the information here is fed in English. It just does the response back. It's smart enough to know that you've asked it a question in another language. So while it's processing in information that's stored in English, it then translates the response to another language. Let's find out.
Oof. Should you mention it doesn't have to be on Sublime?
Get nervous. Yes!
We did it.
Should we drop mic drop right now? Or?
Just don't do a handstand, please.
I guess. Yeah, absolutely. We actually had variations on it. We can make it a little bit more helpful. We can actually prompt it to continue the conversation. We've experimented with that, but right now, because it's just released in production, we want to limit some of the conversations. We want to provide just the information that the users are asking for. Like I mentioned, our next phase is going to be tie into the APIs of the catalog library, so you are able to retrieve real-time information on whether a book is available or not. Yes.
You didn't see the alert, but yeah. Great point.
There is a debug mode that we've built in.
I'm not
allowed to show it, but we can ask it why it's, so I can give it, I'm gonna give it real time for it. So we also built in a feedback loop so that we can analyze that data and provide more info. If you need to kick us off the stage, please let us know, but if there are any,
are there any other questions?
I saw somebody write. Yes.
I have two questions. You said you're using the content, or you're using it to only search query content. Is that also including, like, if someone wants to say, hey, like, what software am I running? Are you also limiting that, or are you limiting, like, what people can paste in, like, scripts?
Great question. So let's find out. Yes, so great question, right? So just safety, essentially for preventing bad things happening to the library based on getting the information back. We did build, like, this is a standard. I'm assuming that my team build a standard filter and smart enough to know, like, to remove code that's coming into the bot. And it itself, so that it's done through, like, standard forms. Sorry, I don't know exactly how it's done, but I know we have talked about it, and so we've eliminated a possibility.
And one more question real fast.
Yeah.
Do you have a demo for mobile, or have you guys tested mobile? Because I'm thinking, like, my wife, she likes to use the AI, like, and, like, Siri or Alexa, so she wants to talk in her phone. She doesn't want to text.
Okay, so that's a great question. I'm gonna test that right after I sit down. because I do that as well. I know that we have looked at accessibility, of course, and I haven't seen it in mobile yet. I'm trying to do the developer tools to find out how to do that if somebody can. Yes, that's a good consideration. And I also wanna add that with this system, the bot is like the simplest UI representation. There are many different implementations that we can, because we have full control. So we've talked about building it in the search itself, so mimicking a search or a conversational search like a chat bot. There are talks about extending it so you can have a Martin County Alexa. The county plans on adopting it countywide, so we will have a ability to have an Alexa and Google Ask Martin County Library type implementation. Yes?
I had a question. So you said it's searching solar for the question they asked, essentially. Does the LLM still keep the context? So say I ask, what's the closest library to this town? And then I ask, what are the hours? Is it searching the site for what are the hours? Or is it smart enough to know what are the hours of the last question?
It's smart. Sorry.
Go ahead. Yeah. No, please go ahead.
Well, I've been asking the question all week, so it knows that I want the library hours in Stuart, Florida. Andy can tell you how it's doing that.
Okay, so let's ask it about a library. So it told me that Elizabeth, is that what it says? Is the furthest library from Stuart. And so now I'm going to just ask it for hours.
You should ask the next thing.
I should. And so it should. So yes, the answer is yes. I'm trying to demonstrate it. We do keep context by feeding the conversation back through the bot so it understands what I've asked for before.
One more thing that I think it's cool, while it's thinking, if you swear at it, it starts to slow down to try to de-escalate. So that's a great feature.
Okay, so it failed on here, but I think it failed because...
It was the 18th time.
Yeah, I think it failed because it keeps on... Because I've asked about other libraries, is my guess, but... For a non-demo conversation, we have tested it, so it does keep context, and we try to feed it. But now we know how to improve it. Thank you. Any questions you want to ask the bot? Yes, in the back. Yeah, great question. Yes, there's throttling that we've put in. There's some caching that we've put in so that if we see same conversations, then those responses get cached so that it's faster. The time that it's thinking, it is actually we're waiting on the LLM. We are using a turbo model. We're going to move over to GCP, Google, but the Drupal module that powers this is flexible enough where we just plug in the destination and a key and it will work with the most popular ones. Yes?
I have a fun prompt.
Yeah.
You ask it for information about library services, but in Limerick.
You want to come up here and get, Limerick? You want to come and give it a try?
Well, you can do style of, it should work, style of Limerick or like a hip hop rhyme.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Let's see if it writes a poem for us. Any other questions before we... Yes?
Which module do you use for connecting to the
LLM? We build the module.
Is it on Drupal.org as well?
It is not on Drupal.org. Wow. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We're very happy to talk about it further.
Hi. Thank you so much, PromoteSource, for sponsoring GovSummit. And great presentation. So for our final case study, we have our wonderful folks from Hounder to come up.
HDMI app. Oh, you have the USB-C right there. Never mind. Yeah. Here we go. I'll take this one.
I'm still here?
Yeah, you do the control. The computer right here.
Check, check.
Hello. Check, check, checking the cache. Check, check. Oh, there we go. Hey, what's up, everybody?
Hello.
All right. Where's my government people at? Here they are. All right. Woo! All right. Woo. Okay. You know what? This is really good because we're more like hollowback type speakers. So the more you give to us, the more we'll give back to you. Okay. Yes. We're gonna make this. We're gonna make this fun. So, really quick, just to. Oh, am I in front of this? There you go. So creating next-gen government website experiences, we're going to be walking you through some neat stories, especially around how Los Angeles Department of Water and Power did this just not that long ago. All right, so...
Are you guys ready?
Are you ready?
Go! Are you
are
sure?
Are you sure? Yes! Okay.
There we go. Woo. Here we go.
Woo. Well, good. Well, hey, everybody. I'm Josh.
Hey, I'm Brian. And we're
and
from...
And we're from...
Hounder.
All right. We practiced that all morning. Welcome to our TED Talk.
Oh, Josh,
everybody.
Josh.
What?
We're at DrupalCon, dude.
Oh, we're at Drupal. Welcome to our Drupal Woo. Talk, everybody.
All right. Okay. Story time. So, LADWP, if you're not familiar, it's LA Department of Water and Power. Mm-hmm. They needed a new website, and they came to us, Hounder, to do it for them. So, they have 2 million customers per day, right, Josh?
Every day.
Every single day.
2 million customers.
And they're the largest utility org in America.
Some say the world.
Some say the world. What else, Josh?
It's also the new utility side of Shohei Ohtani for my LA fans out here. So it's got to be the best, right? We got
to. What was the problem, Josh?
Well, so the problem really was, and we're going to get serious with you now. The problem really at the end of the day, after all the research we've been doing, we just really discovered that people hate government websites.
Yeah.
No one here's ever had a thing like a phone call from an end user around here, right? Never. Okay. Any show of hands who has? Any show of hands? Yes. Okay. Can attest to this.
Right on.
Cool. So what do we do about it, Brian?
Oh, I'm glad you asked me, Josh. We researched our butts off. And what does that mean? That means we developed a really good, strong content strategy for the website. So here we go. Okay. Yeah.
So this is what it looked like.
This existing site. Ew!
You guys are so great, by the way. Thanks for dealing with us.
Yeah, that's great.
So, you just saw what was going on. So as we did a lot of this research, we really went and talked to so many different user cases from all over the county. And we at the end of the day, after doing all that research, we really found four or five main things that people are really trying to do.
Main goals
and a lot of main goals on government sites in general. And those were really, one, wanting to pay their bills.
Yeah, and after that, it's get information on outages in their area, of course.
Yes, and financial assistance. So if they can't just easily pay their bills, what can they get help to do so? What's the information they need to be able to do it?
Yep, and then starting or stop service with any utility.
Yes, and sometimes that starting or stopping service needs to happen fast, right?
Yeah.
Has anyone ever been in that situation? Mm-hmm. So also water and power information for construction. New construction companies in LA, there's a lot of bills going on all the time. So they needed to be able to get the information they needed to do their jobs.
Exactly. So go ahead.
And
Josh.
So the real key to this, though, is that these sites, can we say with it, they really need to be a self-service website. Mm-hmm. Any content writers in here? Content writers.
Ooh, a couple, yeah.
Yeah. Sometimes we get very in love with our own content, right? So we need to make sure that we're always asking ourselves, is it the content allowed for people to, for it to be a self-service website? Is it helping them do that? So this is what we ended up realizing too. So with the self-service is that people actually don't want to talk to you anymore.
They just want to get in and get out, get on with their lives. Again, here's that. Was the existing website. Everyone together.
Ew. Oh, you guys are great.
But maybe it was good for the time, of course. Yeah. And spoiler alert, we're going to actually just show you the end product. So, without further ado.
And everyone, what do you say?
Yes.
Woo,
so, aside from it looking like super sexy, which is, of course, a requirement for any modern website.
Especially government.
Yeah.
Government. Exactly.
That was one of the job requirements, I think.
Yes.
But besides that, there's a lot of thought that goes into this, and we're going to be talking a lot about it. You can see the navigation is very streamlined. There's just a few items with thoughtful buckets under each one. And remember, those five goals that we have, it's you see outages, you see support, login, one click, demo. I mean, that's pretty simple stuff, but we even had safety nets built into the homepage, responsive, of course.
You see those six links? Those are what we're calling just the quick links. Those were safety nets in case they're just completely missing the navigation.
We also, with the thousands of user studies we did, when you have very few items in your navigation, people really start to calm down and think, oh, this is, it's really easy and simple to work with you, to talk with you. There's like that.
It's disarming.
It is. It's really disarming. So think as less as you can in the navigation, everybody. Okay. Keep it as clean as possible.
Which is hard.
And it is really, it is really hard, especially, you know, everyone wants their content on in the navigation. Has everyone ever dealt with that, had that conversation with people? Yeah. So keeping it as simple as possible with a limited amount of options is the best. The other bit, too, is when you're looking at these like these quick links and things like that, the main if you can narrow down the five primary things that people need to do on your website, make sure that whatever those are, that you can easily get to it with one click without having to scroll, without having to look anywhere. If you're if you have to scroll, you have to click anywhere to get there, you're doing it wrong.
Exactly. Yeah, and also, one of the philosophies on the homepage was like less moving parts. We didn't want a lot of like moving carousels or things. Like, again, those goals is like pay my bills, check outages. Like, that's it. And there's some company goals as well that, you know, we got to, you know, there's messaging we need to get across and timely things like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, let's move on.
So, hey, Brian.
Oh, hey, Josh.
So, we just saw what happened. Well, how did we get there?
Oh, I'm glad you asked. So let me blow your mind with something you guys have absolutely never heard before. This is the first time. Are you ready? Being user first, always, of course. Yeah, yes. We've probably heard that thousands of times this week?
Yeah.
But again, it's a concept, but here's how we went about it as Hounder with this project. Who here has journey mapped? Who's done journey mapping?
Journey mapping?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Actually, wow, that's like about half the crew. Sweet. Right. Any insights out of your journey mapping?
Any journey mapping?
Rescindo.
Oh my gosh.
Very true.
Yes. Yeah. Everyone clap for Rescindo. Yeah. That was perfect.
I mean, that's a user first takeaway for sure.
Absolutely.
Anything else?
Anybody else learn anything from journey mapping?
It's difficult when you have multiple audiences doing very different tasks.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah, you're helping me with one of my points. That's great. She said it's difficult when you have so many different tasks. Like, how do you solve for that? Mm-hmm. So let's actually get into that. So just right down to it. This is like the journey map is the blueprint for success. Mm-hmm. So anatomically, it's the brains and also the heart. The heart being for the user, of course. And that's the through line and everything. It's the guardrails keeping us on the road.
So just to kind of jump in, taking all of those pieces that we just talked about or what those site goals are, what the user needs are based on the research, you take that and you map it out based on the content they have on the homepage, what's on the navigation, what's that user journey throughout the site to meet each and every one of those goals.
Yep.
As soon as you start straying away from that, your website strategy starts going to crap. So you gotta just keep things focused on what those goals you're trying to achieve and how you're gonna get people to that information easily.
And there's structured ways we went about that. We did workshops, we did some taxonomy workshops as well. Mm. A lot of back and forth, of course, with the client being the LA team. And they're awesome too. They're the subject matter experts. They knew all the pain points from their users. So it's a lot of give and take there. It's good.
Yeah.
So this is the through line, this is the brains, this is the heart, just keep that in mind. This is like what we always were referring back to get us there. And to get to this level was multiple iterations, so you don't just land there. There's a lot of work.
In fact, the amount of time that gets spent here, and this gets really overlooked in a lot of like enterprise-based website builds, is this actually should take almost just as much time as it takes to build it.
Oh yeah.
Like the thought process behind this is what is so crucial to the end user. And this is something that, you should, when you're doing your sprints, planning them out, make sure you take enough time to get this right.
Yeah. Foundation, cornerstone right there. Cool. So go ahead.
And because we learned a couple things and something we've been touching is that users would rather be watching Netflix than being on your site. It is not the highlight of their day to visit your government site.
Dang straight.
I know. Oh. But 4/5 of the traffic to the site, they are there to pay bill, to check outages, right? And I'm sure for you all, I see a lot of like heads nodding and stuff, that you probably have a good darn idea of what the people need from your site as well.
Exactly. Yeah. And again, if that's the through line, then everything on that site really needs to reflect that, especially on the journey map. And if anyone doesn't know what a journey map is, it's where a user goes from point A to point B. That's as simple as that. So what does that all mean, Josh?
Good question, Brian. It means make it easy for people to give you money.
Cha-ching,
right? Make it easy. Okay. So where does that go?
What does that mean practically? So again, we have the heart we have the brain, we got the heartbeat going, and that's that user journey, all that content mapping, all that stuff. And then where do we go from there? So no good site starts pretty. It starts with these gray blobs, gray boxes. And, you know, if you guys, obviously, you've probably heard of wireframing. And this is the skeletal structure, if we're anatomically speaking. And this is the bones. This is these. But unlike humans, we can actually move these bones around. We start developing components. We start seeing content gaps and existing content because we're dealing with thousands of pages here, and we got to get the users to the right one based on their journey, right? So wireframing, and then after that, the pretty stuff is the paint, the skin, the hair, the pretty clothes, right? And we don't just get there. There's so much work in the wireframing phase. I think we had something like 50 templates that came out of this and about 48 components that did, I think they had 400 variations. And it was just to make it really easy on the back end and the front end, and just very simple visually.
Yeah, and you know, before we go further, Thomas and Renee, who are also the brains behind this in LADWP, yeah, are right back there. Everyone, woo-hoo, say hello, Renee.
They were such great to work, so very, very good to work
They've
with.
They've been signing autographs all week about this project. So, cool.
Do you want to add anything on that one?
You know what, actually, and I mean, I just wanted to mention, too, on the UX side, when it comes to the wireframes, we don't do anything unless it starts with gray boxes, because that is like, and we identify where those content gaps truly are.
Yeah, and you can fail fast. Fail fast. It's easy to move around. You're not like getting too deep. Yeah. And again, no code has been touched at this point.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep. So, and then now we got to test it. So we don't just stop at the research level. That's where a lot of people fail. Like they go into design because they did the research. So they're already convinced that they got the right solution. And to be honest with you, we've done this for so many years, 15 years now, that you can't stop there and just assume you got it right. So what we ended up doing here is we went through a whole usability test, and then we gathered all the different folks. So this is, again, pre-code. So we have it on like a Figma design and things like that, so they can click around and it feels like a website. Right. It's just not built yet. So that way you don't go too far down the road and spend too much money. But what we did is we gathered all the different folks from the different areas. We also, different age groups, different cultures, ethnicities. There's a lot in Los Angeles like that. So we went
languages
and did
too,
that whole, yeah, and the languages. And we looked at all those different demographics and we tested them through 6 different scenarios. Now, one of the things that we really do, and this is something I really want to hone in on, that you can take and start applying tomorrow in your jobs, is when we do these tests, we make it really clear to the person that's doing it is we're not testing you.
Yeah.
We're testing to see if this is going to work for you. So there's, and then we tell them as well, say everything you're thinking. We want to hear what's going on in their brains. When they could say, hey, use the search, and they go, oh, I'm going to go ahead and look in the top right corner because that's where search is, right? Has anyone ever heard of intuitive design? So yeah, oftentimes we think of intuitive because it's what you're used to. That's what intuitive design is. So even if you think you're really creative by putting that search bar in the bottom left because you're really cool, that ain't gonna work too
well. There are universals,
yes,
for sure. Yep.
So keep an eye on those things, but that's what we look. And we also record their facial expressions. Yep. So we take a look at the facial expressions because sometimes they don't always say what they're thinking.
And sometimes, just a tip, when you see them kind of struggling, you can just ask them, like, oh, what are you thinking right now?
Yep.
And you get actually a lot of insight and value out of that as well.
Exactly. So we performed all these tests, and then, survey ended
survey
up saying.
Says. So this actually was a very successful user testing. One of the best quotes that came out of that was, I'm no longer going to dread going to the utility site. I was like, oh, that was so good. And some hard metrics there. It was 80% faster for them to get paying their bill. And I mean, this is great. This doesn't always happen, but we had a literally 100% success rate for these tasks. People were finding everything they needed to find within 10 seconds, most of the time much faster. And again, that doesn't always happen, and you learn from that, and you, of course, adapt. At this point, we had to do minor things, but all this, you know, think about that user journey, all that upfront work before was, you know, prettified on the UI side. It really paid off on this project, and it worked out really well.
And I think there was a goal for a drastic decrease in customer calls, like for website assistance. I think that's still to be determined, though, in terms of that, right, Thomas? Yeah,
right.
So that's still going on. But yeah, but these are the goals, and that's why you need to have those goals set out for to begin with.
Exactly.
So what did we learn here?
What did we learn, guys?
So people don't want to be on your website.
That's right. And your visitors, they want to just get on with their lives and move on.
Yeah, so make it easy on them.
Yeah.
Because it's really user first always, right?
Exactly. It's the heartbeat. It's the golden rule of web design.
Rule.
Yeah.
Golden rule.
And then, of course, make it easy for people to give you money. And in this case, it's pay your bills and just get done, you know?
Exactly. Right. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
We really appreciate this. See y'all. Lunchtime.
That's great. Thanks so much.
Thanks, guys. That's great. All right. Thank you so much, Andrew, for sponsoring Gov Summit. And thanks to all of our sponsors. Now we're going to break. Oh, yeah. So now we're going to break for lunch. It's going to be a kind of grab-and-go lunch. You'll pick it up from Exhibit Hall B, which is just outside and to the right across next to the coffee shop. And then when we come back, we're going to have another presentation about how the National Archives has improved their kind of content editing experience with Gutenberg. And then we'll get into our table talks. So see everyone back here at 1 o'clock. And if you have any ideas for table talks or want to vote on the talks that have already been named, make sure you get up there and add your tallies to those different sites. And the markers are on this front table. Thanks.